Then we move on to the next speaker, Taya Finni. She's from the University of Jyväskylä, and she will talk about the extent of intermuscular force transmission and to ask of answer the question whether this is muscle and activity dependent.
Thank you. Thank you, the organizers, for inviting me. It's a pleasure to hear, to be here to share the passion of this topical area. I will tell you a story about the human lower leg, basically. And many of the ideas that in these studies we have looked are from the animal studies. But in a human, we are much more limited in what we can achieve. And mainly, we can look at the displacements of tissues and not measure the forces. So these are some limitations that should always be kept in mind. But a human lower leg is not one of my interests because it's a simple muscle and a simple structure, but it has a challenging structure. For example, here you see the main force transmitting medium of the triceps surae. Here is the Achilles tendon that then expands to aponeurosis, and here you see actually a part of the aponeurosis runs inside the soleus muscle, and this is where the soleus muscle fibers attach to this side, and gastrocnemius will come up here somewhere. So this is the pathway for the myotendinous force transmission for the triceps surae muscle. And if we take one more closer look at the Achilles tendon, this is an MRI image. So here the Achilles tendon is the black, and this is a bit of the soleus muscle that attaches in its most distal side to the Achilles tendon. And these vary between individuals. So we do have a lot of individual variations in the anatomy too, that is should be kept in mind. But when the tendon fibers run down from the muscle towards the calcaneus, there's a twist in the tendon so that those tendon fibers, fascicles that come from the gastrocnemius medialis down 1 centimeter above calcaneus are actually located proximally, and those from LG are in the anterior side. So it rotates a bit. And there can be variations between individuals. So these anatomical differences, it's important to know the anatomy before you can understand the function. So if we consider the topic of force transmission, and we have a gastrocnemius force here that is transmitted to the Achilles tendon, to its representative areas, we could have a situation like this, where studies from Peter Magnusson's group have shown that between tendon fascicles, there's negligible force transmission. So we could assume that there are high stress concentrations in the cross-sectional area of tendon. And I have seen this in the optic fiber studies, so that when we have high forces, sometimes the optic fiber is bent. And that means that if you bent a polymer fiber, basically, plastic fiber, there needs to be a very high forces that do that. And also Peter Magnusson has had a needle bent in the isometric contractions. So this is really the case. But consider then the force transmission between the muscles that could serve to equalize the stresses in tendon, a little bit maybe. But of course, there's also the neural input that mainly is responsible for this phenomenon, if that is the case. So this is just the basic theory that could have then implications in human movement as well. So before there can be force transmission, there has to be structures, and Hoop showed them in rats, and similarly in several human studies, there has been shown that between gastrocnemius and soleus, there are actually connective tissue structures. So even though they have a distinct different aponeuroses, there are structures connecting the aponeuroses. So these are pictures from Jens Bojsen-Moller, who graciously have given them to me, but also Ruta Ginugasa has done dissections, and John Hodgen and I have published a paper where we describe that there are connections here. So there is possibility for force transmission also in human. But how does this then relate to function? In an isometric contraction, in normal isometric contraction, you often see that the medial gastrocnemius and soleus move in similar manner. And now when we are interested in the force transmission between these muscles, we are interested in how much movement we can see here and on this side of the aponeurosis. However, the displacement in the MG gastrocnemius side and in the soleus side of the aponeurosis can be different in an extended knee condition, for example. Bojsen-Moller showed that the MG displacement is greater than in a flex knee condition. The opposite was the case. So while they can move in similar manner, they can also move in relation to each other, which is natural, a necessity because of the two joint muscle versus one joint muscle. So to look at these, whether there can be force transmission between human plantar flexor muscles in vivo, I went with Kari Kalliokoski, we went down to Copenhagen to do this study actually, and with the hypothesis that there can be forces transmitted between the triceps femoral muscles, but also we were interested, does it happen between the deeper plantar flexor muscles? We had seven subjects, different types of joint manipulations and knee joint positions as well. So we measured ultrasonography from two locations, forces, also under the toe, and we did the passive hallux extension as well and passive knee joint rotations, and we measured EMG activities from flexor hallucis, longus, soleus, MG muscles, and here you see the force records of the under the hallux and also the plantar flexor force, and you may be able to see the toe flexion forces added under the plantar flexion force here. And from the ultrasonography, we quantify the tissue displacement in the MG side of the aponeurosis and in the soleus side of the aponeurosis. And in the distal side here between the soleus and the flexor hallucis longus. And we also looked at the displacement of the flexor hallucis tendon when we were pulling on it. So the hypothesis then is that if we have a passive knee joint motion, if these muscles work independently, we should see only movement in the gastrocnemius muscle. But what we saw was that the MG side and the soleus side moved approximately the same amount, suggesting that when you extend the knee, there needs to be some interaction between these muscles. In another condition, we did a selective stimulation of the MG muscle using percutaneous electrodes here, And previous experiments where we measured glucose uptake, or I wasn't involved in these studies, but Jens and Kari measured glucose uptake and confirmed that this particular stimulation protocol activated only the gastrocnemius muscle. We could examine whether there could be force transmission from an active muscle to a passive muscle. So this is now in an extended knee position. So MG stimulation, MG activated, there was a movement, a proximal movement indicating fascicle shortening. We didn't quantify it in this study. And then there was also movement, a little bit less movement in the soleus side. But in the distal sampling side, we didn't see very much displacement here. So this is important because that, you know, Hoop's presentation, he showed that there is a possibility for forces to be transmitted also through more distal side, through the Achilles tendon. But there's in this study, we saw very little movement down there. And in a flexed knee position, they actually moved the same amount. So they moved in unison. And again, in the distal sampling side, there's very little displacement here going on. So it appears that it is in a more proximal. There must be mechanical interaction, if I may, more proximally. So then, would there be force transmission between these muscles, flexor hallucis longus and soleus muscle? When we pulled on the toe, the flexor tendon here, we saw movement in this direction, but very little movement here in the knee extended and knee flexed position. The same story, very little movement here. And that leaves the possibility open. I'm not sure that the model is perfect to look at the force transmission between these muscles, but the data is inconclusive in that sense. And similarly, isometric hallux flexion, where we try to control, we measure the EMGs, and not all subjects can really activate purely the hallux flexor. So we saw that there's proximal displacement of the tendon side, but very little movements here. So what we concluded in this study was that between soleus and gastrocnemius, there can be force transmission, but it was not so clear between the triceps rugae and flexor hallucis longus. This was done in 2010, or published 2010, and then a couple years after that, this is already shown by Hoob, the Australian group did passive knee joint rotations with the intent to quantify the forces transmitted between the soleus and gastrocnemius in this passive condition. And what they concluded was that they are very marginal, the forces. But I have always thought that, okay, when you have an active condition, the story may be different. Last year, the Japanese San Diego group published a paper where they studied using MRI techniques displacement of medial gastrocnemius and soleus and quantified the displacement of the aponeurosis. And interestingly, what they did in their study, they compared the timing of the soleus and MG displacement as well, so how well they were in synergy during the concentric plantar flexion while they were imaging. So they actually showed that when there were no temporal differences between the movement of the two muscles, the the interaponeurosis shear, or the relative displacement between these two muscles, was lowest, and the muscle tendon junction displacement was the highest. And therefore, I sort of think that if you can minimize the relative displacement here, so have a low shear strain, it could not only imply that there could be force transmission between muscles, but also it could amplify the myotendinous force transmission. So coming back to this active versus passive condition, what is the role of muscle activation in the possible force transmission? I and Neil got a grant from the university to go down to have fun in Australia, so we did. At least I had fun, and the others worked hard in the lab. And what we wanted to look was it that the if you have a passive versus active condition, is there a change in the relative displacement of these muscles indicative of changes in force transmission? And really, we looked at, is the interaponeurosis shear reduced in active as compared to passive condition? And the theory behind this is, as Hubel also mentioned, that the connective tissue stiffness may change upon activation, and this is a classical paper from Lieber showing that in vitro aponeurosis actually can have a much higher stiffness than in a passive condition. And also in human MRI experiments, I and others have shown that the aponeurosis behavior is not intuitive. It's not, may not be stretching all the way along, but it's non-uniform, and there can be also parts of the aponeurosis shortening while during contraction. And if you consider that the muscle belly shortens, you would assume that, of course, the aponeurosis that is adjacent to it, attached to it, is shorter during contraction. Although it's a passive and elastic component. So what we did here, we did shorter stretches of knee extension, both in a passive condition and then when we selectively activated gastrocnemius lateralis muscle, and we measured fascicle length and quantified the shear between these on both sides of the aponeurosis. So we had a actually quite complex setup where we had stimulating electrode in the lateral gastrocnemius. We tried to confirm that there was no M wave in the soleus, medial or lateral soleus, and that we had still had a twitch force while there was no soleus activity. And we had a knee joint angle in a quite tight position, so we could have even small forces recorded. So what we did first was passive knee joint rotation, during which we this is basically the study repetition of the study by the Australian group Tian et al. And what we saw was a bit similar story than what they found, that when the knee joint is flexed, the gastrocnemius shortens, but the adjacent proximal soleus doesn't change much in length, but some small changes in the distal length there can be. Well, this was not the main part of our study, but the main topic was that we induced stretches from four different knee joint angles. So from 30 degrees, we stretched it up to 10 degrees and measured this stretch in a passive, and then when we had the gastrocnemius lateralis selectively activated. And this is a protocol, so we first had the passive stretch, then stimulation, and then the stretch during the stimulation. And here we see a lateral gastrocnemius fascicle length changes, shortening up and activation, lengthening, and then relaxation. Soleus fascicle, we measured the forces as well. And we calculated the effects of passive stretch by subtracting these points and active stretch by subtracting these points. And we also looked at the effect of pure contraction of the LG as well. So what does the contraction of a muscle do to the fascicle length changes, for example? And this is the effect of the stimulation only, not the stretch. So when you stimulate a gastrocnemius muscle only, regardless of at which length you do it, the gastrocnemius lateralis shortens about 8 millimeters. But proximal soleus also shortened, and that's because this fascicle is shortened, and I think the aponeurosis is being pulled proximally here, and the soleus is thereby shortening passively. But there's very little movement in the distal soleus. So what happened to the aponeurosis shear? So this is a picture showing relative displacement, so that more displacement in the gastrocnemius than soleus up here. And in a passive condition, when we have a passive stretch of a gastrocnemius muscle, we see that the gastrocnemius moves more than the soleus. And it was dependent on the joint angle. So the difference between the displacement was greatest at the knee joint angle, smallest knee joint angle. But when we activated one muscle, the both sides of the aponeurosis moved in unison. So there was more force and less relative displacement. So I think this is indicative of stiffening the tissues between the aponeurosis. So here I'm bold enough to conclude that the aponeurosis is stiffer in active than in passive condition. And summarizing the whole talk is that we do have structures that could transmit forces between human gastrocnemius and soleus. The movement, just the passive movement of gastrocnemius affects soleus, and the interaction is likely to occur locally and not so much through the Achilles tendon. And the activation can decrease the interaponeurosis shear strain, which is indicative of enhanced myofascial force transmission, but also could enhance myotendinous force transmission. And I'd like to thank my co-workers and you for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Taya, for this nice presentation and showing some real new data. This paper is open for questions.
Oh, thanks for that presentation, Taya. I was wondering if you have any speculation on why there is more or less shearing between the aponeuroses in the active condition. Is that just because when the muscle shortens, it may expand and increase the frictional force between the two aponeuroses, allowing them to move together? Or is there some other mechanism there?
Well, where does the friction come from? If you just contract one muscle, okay, that is stiffer. But what is the friction then? I don't know what you mean by friction.
I guess if one muscle shortens, then its diameter usually increases if it's isovolumetric, which means there's an increase in the lateral push, the lateral force, course friction is proportional to the the normal force.
Yeah.
Could it be friction, or is there some other mechanism here?
Yeah. Well, that's of course one possibility, but I'm thinking it that way, that if you have these connective tissue structures there, and previously in vitro and in situ experience has shown that they can change the configuration or properties upon activation, could that be the likely mechanism here also? And perhaps the friction could be also a small part? I don't know.
Thank you.
Yes, Chris.
Hi, Chris Thijs for University of Amsterdam. Many thanks for your clear story. Dion and all did a calculation of what the force transmission would be with passive conditions. Based on your study, could you do a prediction?
Of course, we could do predictions, but knowing what I know, perhaps simple models are not enough, and if we want to really quantify, I need some help in that. Yeah.
Thanks, and I got a more methodological question. Did you control the ankle angle during knee extension? Because I
yes.
think also the group of Herbert showed that knee extension can affect the ankle angle, although
yeah.
it's...
We were careful to really have the ankle angle at tight. So we had actually a 85-degree ankle angle, joint angle, so it was in a small tension there to start with in our experiments. So it was really tight setup for the ankle.
So, and also then the activation of the gastrocnemius could not, change the foot properties, dimensions.
I'm confident that that's very, very minimal.
Thank you.
Maybe comment on that is that, sorry, Tara. I think last year Rob Herbert published a paper where they actually measured the ankle angle during all their conditions, and despite the fact that they tried to secure it as good as possible, they still found like about a 5 degrees change in ankle angle.
Not the case here.
Yes,
hi, Tom O'Brien from the UK. Sorry, in the middle. Hi. You showed us lots of pictures with the soleus and the GM, and what's obvious and what we know is obviously the pennation angle means that they meet in a V shape. You also see the same arrangement between the VL and the VI in the quadriceps. I wonder if that's an anatomical adaptation that would facilitate a transfer of displacement from one muscle into the other muscle, and would result in the shortening of the other muscle appropriately. If you think that might be the case, I accept it, it's a speculative question. Are there any muscles that we think of that have the reverse arrangement, and would transfer of displacement be different between those muscle groups?
I have only looked at the pinnate muscles. I would assume that the case is different for the parallel muscles. I've also looked at the rectus femoris and vastus intermedius relative displacements. And there we see also individual patterns, actually, how they move in relation to each other. So I think we're just at the very beginning of trying to understand and comprehend this, and certainly more experiments are needed in different conditions, and before we can, you know, try to formulate a more solid view on what's going on. Is it muscle specific and so on?
Okay, thank you.
So we have time for a brief question and a brief answer, please.
Just Hans Hoppler again from BAM. You showed that most of your study was during using concentric contraction, knowing that the tension developed in eccentric contraction, or the forces are maybe 10 times higher. What would you think happens under extreme eccentric conditions?
Actually, we did, my studies are in isometric condition. The MRI study that I showed, that was in concentric condition. And in this active versus passive condition, the forces were really, really low. They were only 20% of higher than the passive ones. But even with this low force level, as we saw, there can be forces transmitted. And based on some animal experiments, I would be tempted to say that it could increase as a function of force level. So my answer is yes, the forces, higher forces, could further enhance this or further stiffen the structures.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Taya. Thanks again.
Thank you.